We have two of the partners that you listed there, Cranfield and the Technology Strategy Board. So, Steve, what role have the academics and academia played in this? What's your role in this been?
Well, our role has been to provide one of the payloads for us, but also we've been involved in, actually, through providing the payload, involving students in the work that's going on at Cranfield, so that we as staff have been involved in some of the teaching, some of the research to develop the payload. But it's also been a fantastic opportunity for us both to develop our skills, develop our technologies, but also to work with the students. And you can imagine how motivating it is to have an opportunity like Tech Demo Start to work with current students at the very start of their career in the space industry. This is an experience that will very quickly bring them up to speed, and they can carry that forward right through into their careers.
Is this a first, or have you done similar things in the past?
The university has been involved in several other payload projects as over many years now, but for us as a space group, where we've done most of the teaching, this has been an excellent first opportunity for us.
And what's your experience been involvement in these projects in the past? What has the experience been of what happens to the students? Do they end up, if they've been involved in one of these projects at the university, do they then end up going into the business?
Well, certainly from Cranfield, students generally come to Cranfield because they're looking for jobs in the industry. That's the sort of place that Cranfield is. And so, yes, a vast majority of our students are going off into careers into the space industry. I think we've counted up something like 500 of our alumni now out in the UK space industry. Surrey Satellites is an excellent...
Our Director of Engineering is actually a Cranfield alumni.
Yes. Good.
Yes, so in the space industry, whenever I go to meetings in the UK or in Europe, I'm coming across some of our graduates. And, you know, as an educator, that's a fantastic privilege, really, to see them moving on into careers where they're making a difference and that they're really enjoying as well.
What are the basic ground rules that you've developed for managing collaborations like this? Because culturally, potentially, high-tech manufacturing is very different from academia. So what do you need to get right at the outset in order for these collaborations to work most effectively?
Well, the collaborations come down to people. So the people must get on well together and respect each other's contributions, so that I think that requires some understanding as to where people in industry are coming from, what drives them. So we as academics need to understand that, but also the people from the industry need to understand the constraints, the drives that we in academia work within. But I've recently been successful with a project proposal that we've been working on. And one of the things that's been really pleasing to me is that very easily in the UK, I've been able to bring together a partnership that goes right through from some sort of leading scientists, including a company like SSTL manufacturing satellites, ourselves interested in some of the science systems and applications, but right through to Earth observation companies who are eventually going to exploit these products. And being able to put together a team like that, that covers such a broad range of spectrum so easily and conveniently within the UK, has been really quite satisfying to me, and I think makes it a particularly exciting project.
Doug, can I ask you, how far is this collaboration modelled on previous ones? Are there things about it that are different, that are groundbreaking?
From the point of view of SSTL, yes. In the past, when we've done demonstration missions, we've tended to focus more on just providing SSTL technologies that we wish to demonstrate. And the very nature of this, and that it was an open call, and we engaged fully across the UK, meant that we're now doing something which is quite different, which is we're respecting the intellectual property of the other consortium members. We have an open set of agreements between us commercially, which has been very interesting to set up, and going forward it's going to be very interesting to see how that develops. And yeah, it's been very new for us.
How challenging, setting up an open set of agreements, how challenging was that?
We obviously spent the first 3 months of the programme doing that instead of the useful engineering. But we've now got a model, I think, that we can use going forward for future missions. And we'd like to see this as not just a one-off. We think this is something that we could do every few years. And that actually would be groundbreaking, because when you're developing new space technologies now in the UK, you would have this awareness that every 2 or 3 years, one of these missions would be flying, which means that you don't plan to do a lengthy campaign on the bench or using a thermal vacuum chamber somewhere. You actually just make a decision when you're doing your development plan that at some point you are going to get an opportunity to put your new thing into orbit.
Iain Gray, let's move on to you, because the Technology Strategy Board is also one of the partners. What's your role here? What function do you perform?
So, I mean, put very simply, the Technology Strategy Board is UK Innovation Agency. Our vision is to accelerate UK economic growth through stimulation and support of business-led innovation. I mean, what we've seen in the last 10, 15 minutes is just one example of that sort of collaboration. We've been responsible over the last 5 years since we were first set up for investing some £2 billion worth of public sector money in partnership with the private sector. Many of the examples we've actually seen here today, we have made some contribution to that, and the fruits of the success of that investment are manifested in a lot of the products we see here. It's interesting, I mean, the UK has an acknowledged terrific research base through the universities. We currently support some 4,000 businesses across different sectors, energy to transport, digital, manufacturing. Of those 4,000 companies that we support, roughly speaking about 3,000 projects, around two-thirds of those involve universities. They are university spin-outs, they're universities from a knowledge perspective. There's many different types of tools that we adopt, collaborative R&D funding, smart funding, knowledge transfer partnerships between universities and small businesses. We've heard a lot in previous discussions about the role of centres, the catapult centres, the innovation and knowledge centres. So what we've seen for the last 20 minutes, in my view, is a terrific example of how a university idea has sort of grown out into a spin-out business. It's continued to develop in a collaborative sense, and the role of a Technology Strategy Board is both a convening body in helping to move these collaborations forward, but it's also providing support to these type of examples through funding, through knowledge transfer, through exploring and finding future markets for where this is going. And Tech Demosat, actually, due to launch first half of next year. I mean, I think it's a hugely exciting project in terms of not just the commercial side of it, but exciting young children and exciting small businesses to see that kind of opportunity.
And is there anything particular about this project that you could, as it were, template and apply elsewhere from your perspective?
Well, I think what the project has illustrated is the long-term nature of the innovation game. I mean, some of the early ideas that came out in Martin's video 10, 15 years ago. I mean, SSTL is now part of a much larger corporate organisation, EADS, and it's how do you preserve that sort of small company innovation culture in developing commercial success. I think it's a great model of showing how small businesses can evolve out of universities. It's getting the right stimulus at the right time. It's being market-led, and it's actually developing the collaboration between different businesses and academia moving forward. So as a template, it's a great example. We picked this as one example. I mean, there are many other in this room today. I mean, intelligent energy, Thomas Swan, Harry stood up and spoke earlier about sort of nanotechnologies or whatever. There's aerospace, we could have picked a number of other examples that illustrate the same sort of facet and the same sort of template. But it's a strong word of encouragement that business working together with academic and harnessing that research base is worth fighting for. It's a great prize from a UK PLC perspective.
Doug, how do you preserve that sort of small company commitment to innovation and so on when you're part of a multinational conglomerate?
I think a lot of that was down to the manner in which we were acquired. Our parent company, Astrium, part of EADS, made a decision that they were acquiring us because we were special, not because they wanted to change us. And they've left us very much alone to pursue the processes and to keep the company ethos. So I think we can thank our owners that we managed to maintain the same kind of company approach. The bigger danger we have is that we are growing, as Martin said, I mean, I joined SSTL 11 years ago, and we were just over 100 then, and we're nearly 500 now.
Yeah.
And that is, you know, it's interesting going through those growth pains from going an SME to becoming a medium to large size company and still maintaining a way of working which has been successful for you. And that's one of the bigger challenges we have, not being acquired by EADS Astrium.
Alan Cook, do we do enough of these collaborations between industry and academia? Should we be doing more?
Well, I think we should always be doing more. We should always be striving to do more, to take on board, you know, the Olympics mandate, or the mantra that you mentioned earlier on this morning, Nick. I mean, you know, it's faster, higher, stronger. I think we always have to strive to do better than what we're doing currently. And I mean, otherwise, we're not just standing still, we're actually going backwards. So the simple answer is absolutely we have to do more of it. It has to start not just with the universities, it has to start with the schools. I'm also involved with the UTCs, University Technical Colleges, that were mentioned earlier on. Getting kids excited, enthused, really keen to develop a career in engineering, manufacturing, technology is absolutely essential. So there's, yeah, of course we've got to be doing more. But I have to say that I think that within this current coalition government, there are, I mean, just the fact that we have a number of politicians here today is an indication of the sort of level of support that is available for us. I do sympathise a lot with a couple of comments that were made with SMEs. They're not big, but I've always maintained that it's the likes of GKN and Rolls-Royce and Siemens that actually help stimulate some of the work that's going on with the SMEs and helping them to develop their capability even more.
Anybody else? We've a couple of minutes before we move on. Anybody else want to come in and raise any questions, comments about what they've heard? Gentleman at the back, anybody, you sir have already asked a question and I'm happy to give you another go, but is there anybody else? You too, sir. two veteran. This gentleman over here, and then we'll hear from our previous.
John Binner, Loughborough University. I've been involved in academia now for nearly three decades, and I've run an awful lot of research projects, probably 150 to 200, many of which are government helped, as well as industry. Really two comments. We do a lot of very, very good things here, but two things that I've noticed in that time. One, we don't seem to be able to be consistent in the way we interact with government support to academia industry. It seems to change every few years, which just keeps on setting us back in terms of learning the new rules of the game. And secondly, in all that time, I haven't actually observed a scheme which is deliberately and expressly designed to take technologies right down the TRL scale. We fund either at TRL 1 to 3, or we fund at 4 to 6. We don't really have a scheme which takes things, the best, the most commercially viable ideas, right the way down that scheme and across the so-called valley of death. Any comments about that?
Who wants to come back on that?
I'm happy to go first on that. I mean, I think in terms of your first point about longevity and having consistency in how we do things is a really important point. We've got colleagues here from Germany. I know Jürgen and colleagues from Siemens from Germany would talk about the longevity of the Fraunhofer brand, for example. And the Fraunhofer brand has been around some 40, 50 years. You find that institutionally, people know what the Fraunhofer brand is. Whether it's good, bad, or indifferent is irrelevant to this point. They know what it is. What we need to do is establish those sort of tools where there is consistency of purpose. And the objective of establishing the catapult centres, and we've now got catapult centres in high-value manufacturing, which are looking at, Roger would know about the terrific work up at Sheffield and the Advanced Manufacturing Research Centre, Boeing and Rolls-Royce started that off. We've got the Centre for Process Industries up at Wilton, the National Composites Centre, Warwick Manufacturing, the Manufacturing Technology Centre. The consistency of purpose around the catapults as a long-term play is massively important. And we now have catapult centres in offshore renewable energy and energy. We have a catapult centre in cell therapy, which, by the way, is also sort of introducing manufacturing back into the UK in a domain that we've not been involved in the past. We've got a catapult in satellite applications technology. We've got a catapult in future cities, integrated transport systems, connected digital economy. And I think it's massively important we retain the long-term vision of in 10 years, 20 years' time, people look back and can talk about the, you know, the genesis of the catapult centres, but they're still here and there. In terms of things we could do differently, I mean, I think just sessions like this where people cite examples of where university and business has really worked successfully together, make sure that people don't get scared of each other. There's a different lexicon, and you've got to make sure that business and university can talk the same language.
Take a question at the back there.
Richard Godwin, I'm a technology innovation specialist based in the US, and it struck me that the UK is the only country that's built its own launch vehicle, put its own satellite into space, and then said, okay, been there, done that, let's go down the pub. And what tends to happen is that an urban legend in the US that if you are an entrepreneur in America and you come and sit in a pub in Cambridge and make notes of the conversation at the next table, you'll do quite well. In my work for SpaceX over here, I've spoken to some researchers at several universities here, and I've asked them how many patents or patents their university has, and they get no response, they get no help from the university. If they have a new patent, they're expected to pay for it themselves, and I don't see how that can help the UK economy at all.
Anybody want to come back very, very quickly on that?
Well, I think if I could come back on the Cambridge side, I mean, we don't sit in pubs, actually. We use companies like Marshalls in Cambridge to actually really develop and nurture those smaller businesses where we can actually develop those ideas. So I do take your point. I think the nuclear industry is another point in question where we've actually allowed that skill to take it further.
Right, and at that point, as the band really strikes up, thank you very much indeed to all our speakers, Allan Cook, Doug Liddle, Steve Hobbs, Iain Gray, and virtually Sir Martin Sweeting. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.